bit.
Right. Hello, welcome to the Hack Lab. This particular BOF is multi-threading why and how we should use it by Ben Hutchings. If you would like to submit a book, a straddler. Yes. Oh, here you go.
Everyone here has actually used multi-threading somewhat. So. Okay, so having used multi-threading and knowing a fair bit about it, I have to say it's they're a fairly good way to obfuscate the flow of your program. They make it extremely difficult to test and debug. Most errors related to multi-threading are problems with synchronization, they depend on the timing, so they only result, they tend to appear quite randomly and possibly only under heavy load, which you don't see in testing, it only appears on some users' system. Finally, the language and library semantics of multi-threaded programs are mostly quite vaguely defined. So it's really difficult to write correct programs if the underlying language doesn't define how to write them correctly. However, they're a necessary evil. With multi-core and hyper-threading processes becoming standard in desktops and even laptops now, you need to make use of those multiple processes, of course. Servers, of course, already tend to have multiple processes, and to use those, you need multiple threads. You could have multiple processes as well, but inter-thread communication is a lot cheaper. If you have multiple processes, they can share memory, but then you have much the same problems there as with threads which share all their memory. Also, if you use shared memory between processes, the shared memory can have a different address in each process, and that causes the same problems. You can't use raw pointers, you can't use C++, a polymorphic object, because they have pointers in them. So, yeah, you need to use threads in many cases. So, how do we structure applications into threads? Easy ways, which I imagine everyone's tried, are in a server program you have one kernel thread for each client, which is fairly easy to do. One problem with that is it uses lots of virtual address space. Each thread gets, and Linux, each thread by default gets 8 megabytes of stack space. You can reduce that, but that may not happen. Depending on what thread library you're using. And you've got the kernel resources associated with the thread as well. And if you've got 1,000 clients simultaneously, 1,000 threads, there's a huge scheduling and huge overhead for scheduling and synchronization between those. So you don't really make good use of the process resources if you have a lot of clients. If you have a few clients, that it works out just fine. For interactive applications, you might use one thread per task. So it might be UI thread, thread for network I/O, thread for file I/O, and so on. But if you do it that way, then you're going to find one of these tasks you've divided the program into does the bulk of the processing. The others are mostly blocked on I/O. So if you have multiple processes, one of them may run flat out doing this intensive processing, the others the the others will not be used. So that's pretty wasteful. If you really want to use all the available resources, you need to be a bit more sophisticated. For a server application, you need to have a thread pool, and then you assign one thread to each processor. Well, you create one thread for each processor in the system, and hopefully OS schedules them properly. You can maybe hint with processor affinity to get that to work better. But of course that's harder to write. Effectively you have to have your own scheduler to assign jobs to those threads. It doesn't necessarily interact well with other applications, because if you have multiple applications each trying to use all processors, they're clearly are going to be swapping. You're going to have reschedules, so we won't. And finally, if you do it that way, all your I/O needs to be non-blocking. Or if you have to do blocking I/O, you can then have extra threads in the pool and release them when one thread is about to block, and then move to, at some point, return that thread to the pool rather than putting a new job onto it so that you only have one thread per processor. It's all really rather complicated. I don't have a good answer for that. For interactive applications, whatever processor intensive work you have to do, if there is any, it's not always true, that really needs to be parallelized. So again, one thread per processor to do whatever it is, graphics manipulation, video processing. And for high performance computing, with number crunching, there are frameworks that make this somewhat easier, but I don't believe they're that well suited to other kinds of applications. Synchronization. Obviously, things need to be synchronized so they don't trample over each other's changes to shared memory. So if you don't do it in the right places, your program breaks. But if you're doing it all over the place, say you have a mutex for every single little piece of data, your threads are likely to spend an awful lot of time waiting for each other. So if your threads are all blocked, or mostly blocked, then you're not using the processor time that's available. The program doesn't make use of the resources. So, for synchronization, probably know about mutexes, aka locks and condition variables, which are reasonable building blocks, but they're pretty low level. One of the well-known problems with locks is deadlocking. If you have two threads that need to acquire locks need to acquire multiple locks at the same time, they're doing different orders, you can get deadlock. You need to establish a lock ordering. Well, how do you do that? And if you're writing a library, say, and that needs to be thread safe, it needs mutexes to protect this internal state. And maybe while holding this mutex, it has a callback. Then there's a hidden mutex that needs to participate in this lock ordering, and yet you don't even know about it. So it's very difficult to actually put together multiple blocks of code in this way. One thing that is being quite seriously researched is lockless algorithms and data structures. You may know that those are being increasingly used in the kernel. There's this technique called read-copy-update, which allows you to avoid using a mutex when updating some shared structure, obviously in the kernel. The kernel is effectively a multi-threaded system. Everything is shared between all purchases in the kernel. So those can give you higher performance and avoid deadlocking, but they're very, very hard to write, very hard to use, except for experts only. One of the commonly used lockless algorithms is double check locking. This is a technique for hopefully speeding up initialization. So if you do lazy initialization of some a pointer to a single object, you can. Well, no, it won't now exactly. But it's a common idea. You check a variable before taking the lock. The trouble with it is it's broken. It just doesn't work. And yeah, that was advocated for years by experts at the time. So earlier on, I mentioned the language semantics. We tend to assume, although we should know better, that the operations of our programs, such as reading and writing variables, synchronizing, and doing I/O, are done in the same order as they're written. But of course, that doesn't really happen. You have compiler optimizations that reorder them to make the program run faster. This includes eliminating and duplicating memory accesses in some cases by caching variables and registers. Also, some processors don't support writing variables of some sizes. For example, on an alpha, on early alphas at least, you couldn't write to an individual byte. You'd have to read a 64 word, I think, modify that one byte in the word, write back the whole word. So if you had two variables that sharing that word, actually writing one of them writes to the other. So that can introduce race conditions into a program that apparently doesn't have them. Also, processes reorder reads and writes depending on which part of the memory system they're in. They do them, tend to do them as quickly as they can. There are some constraints on that, but yeah, if you're writing to it's reading actually. There's a bigger problem if you read from if you read a variable that happens to be in main memory, and then you read from a variable that's in a cache. The variables in the cache actually gets read earlier. This is all okay in a single-threaded program, although it does cause some problems for signal handlers. So. And that's why it's allowed, that's why compiler writers get away with it. But as I said, it introduces race conditions into multi-threaded programs. And the same goes for processors that use shared memory with other processors. You have the synchronization primitives such as mutexes, which deal with this process or reordering, but they don't necessarily inhibit compiler reordering. In general, because the mutex, lock, and unlock functions aren't seen by the compiler, it can't assume what goes on in those functions. So it has to effectively flush variables to memory around those. But there are some cases, such as where the lock and unlock are conditional, where that doesn't actually happen. So the compiler introduces race conditions. In order for a language to support non-threading properly, it needs to have a memory model that defines exactly what reordering is possible, and what can be done by the compiler and processor to reorder the operations, and how you as a programmer can limit it. But I don't. In general. There is a notable exception. Java does have a memory model that covers multiple threads. But I don't know about you, Java's not my favorite language. The C and C++ languages is currently stuck with a single-threaded abstract machine. So if you use multi-threading, normally you're using the POSIX thread semantics, but bad luck, POSIX speaks in terms of memory locations, not in terms of variables and other elements of language semantics. So it doesn't help. There is some active work on a memory model, a multi-threaded memory model for C++ language. Some of that may be applicable to C. C#, which I guess we're going to see more on Linux, it's too mono. It has a multi-threaded memory model, but it's a bit vague, so you're on some budget territory there. Higher level languages, I'm afraid I don't know. There may or may not be a problem. It's all dependent probably on the whatever language that's whatever lower level language it's implemented in. So why am I talking about this at a Debian conference? If you're maintaining a program that uses multi-threading, which more and more programs do, you are likely to see, I think, increasing numbers of bug reports due to synchronization errors in those programs that pop up as people are using multiprocessor machines. You may also see problems resulting from the language semantics, and Debian obviously supports multiple architectures. They don't all have the same rules for processor reordering, so you might find some problems occur with some architectures and not others. You've got to watch out for that. So I don't have a lot of good news, I'm afraid. There's some links here to further reading, which I guess I'll put this talk up somewhere on my homepage. So I think we go to questions, discussion now.
I didn't understand your point about the out of order execution that you had. When I think of C or C++, I think of sequence points at places like semicolons and the double and sign and the double or sign. Where is my conception missing there?
Well, sequence points themselves are a little something of a misnomer. They aren't points in the program. That's possibly where some of the confusion comes from. Sequence points are restrictions, not really restrictions on reordering. They say that this has happened before that, but the compiler is allowed to reorder as if things had happened in that order. So you have the rule that if you write to a variable twice without a sequence point between the two writes, i.e. without any order between those, then those semantics are undefined. If you have a sequence point between them, then that's fine. But the compiler might see that these two writes occur, there's no read between them, so it just eliminates the first write. But it might be that you arrange a program such that another thread reads between those. The compiler doesn't have to know about that and doesn't.
And the only way to fix that would be to declare every one of those variables volatile, then, wouldn't it?
No, volatile is only vaguely specified. That's another part of the problem.
I think that the whole execution model or the whole virtual machine model for C++ is centered around the word volatile. A C++ compiler is conforming to the specification if a compiled program is doing all volatile accesses in the same order and as an unoptimized program. And it may leave out a non-volatile access at will. If you have like 10,000 registers, it may use registers instead of memory for structures. As long as these are not volatile. The volatile is only going to have to the point that if you have a volatile access that is protect, you can use volatile accesses to protect to enforce sequence points because volatile access.
Well, no, you can't. Volatile accesses are real are ordered with respect to each other, but it doesn't say anything about non-volatile or non-volatile accesses that appear to be between them. They can still be moved.
True.
So we'll be reordered past the volatile.
If you use an mutex, then you are guaranteed that the mutex is ordered in respect to volatile, and I think even non-volatile.
The mutex should be mutex acquire and release should prevent any acquire and release. Anything that occurs between them should not can't move past those. In theory, but as I said, there's an odd case where if your acquire and release are conditional, I'll see if I can dig up an example of this for you later. Has been observed that a compiler will do an optimization with caching a variable to a register that introduces a race condition there, and actually, what the compiler is doing is perfectly legal according to the language spec. I don't know whether this can ever occur if the acquire and release are not conditional. It might theoretically be possible.
I have a multi-threading Perl process that winds up on the multiprocessor system that the production version runs on that gets a lot of load. It occasionally has bugs and I can't reproduce it on my single processor test system.
It doesn't show up on a single system.
Part of it is just the slower processor, and part of it is just.
But from what I've heard, I don't have a lot of experience with this, but from what I've heard, you can have multi-threading bugs that almost never appear on single processor systems because you only have one thread at a time running, and so the race condition is only exposed if you have a context switch in those few cycles. But of course, if you actually have multiple threads running in parallel, then you get them after a few minutes.
Yes.
Maybe a bit longer in your case, but this is the sort of thing you can see. I really don't know how multi-threading support.
Question about thread development under Linux. Is there hope for a bit more awareness of the existence of threads under Linux? I mean, every time you look for any programming implementation of any library, it's all for the single thread case, and you have in case you have multi-thread, it's kind of messy, but just lock everything with a big multi-ex, and then it basically stops. And every system code you make, you may have these little different semantics, and you're always looking at stuff. Well, yeah, some are in the interruption points, some are not.
Interruption points.
Cancellation points.
Cancellation.
You end up looking at one page and specifications lawyer, and it's kind of hard to do it.
My advice about cancellation would be don't use this. Don't use cancellation. Use a condition variable and check that instead.
But then, you get signals.
Signals on threads are a really horrible case, yeah.
It's kind of like a bad hack in a way. The thread support, in many cases, you kind of have to hack it into something which is used 99% of the time for one thread. I'd like to see, I guess it's just a rant of mine, but I'd like to see examples for the multi-thread system in GTK libraries and stuff. and to feel comfortable using threads instead of feeling like a freak if I do it. Yeah, I guess that's not a very useful thing I'm saying, but I just wanted to get that out.
I don't have any terribly good advice on this. I can't point you to a guide which will tell you how to do it.
Collections of code examples, FAQs, like rewrites of the GTK tutorial with examples with like where to stick the fucking context.
Really, you want to share information between threads as little as possible. You want to have the ability to share or transfer ownership between threads, but you want to share as little as possible so that once a thread has, or if a thread has a single ownership of something, it doesn't need to use mutexes, it never has to worry about blocking to access that. So if you can, if you can possibly arrange for only one thread to need access to some state, then that may be better than letting every thread access this. Say the state of GTK, and then having to put mutexes in.
Yeah, well, formally you would need to declare everything that is ever transferred between two threads as volatile to enforce it to be actually written out.
Volatile doesn't even solve the problem.
Well, you can force...
Because again, volatile is defined for a single threaded abstract machine, and it may or may not do what you need in a multi-threaded system. In particular, in most implementations of CMC++, volatile does not inhibit processor reordering.
Yes,
it does, but in most it does not.
The problem that the single processor machine specification has. You can tell whether a subroutine call will do volatile accesses. So any volatile accesses will have to have happened before a subroutine call, such as a call into the piece of library to get a mutex. So while it's...
Yeah, but as I said, that there are some optimizations that can be done, it seemed like that would be true, but there is that case of the conditional loss.
The volatile accesses will force the compiler to emit the instructions for actually writing the data, and the mutex grab has a memory barrier on, so the access would have happened actually at this point, so it's quite safe. Oh, it should be safe.
Yes, you're probably right. Yeah. But you can't afford to make all of them all the time.
Yeah, that's a problem.
Yeah.
And we'd need better compilers that basically would understand if you have a volatile buffer and or volatile data.
Or first, you need a specification for those compilers.
No,
we need to fix a language thing.
No, it's actually just a matter of implementation. If you have shared volatile objects and you have a working copy that's not volatile, you can work on your working copy, which can be cached in the register as you like it, and you just need to copy it over the volatile area, and the compiler should be able to sort this out. That's an implementation issue.
So what about the the memory model of scripting languages like Perl, Python, Ruby? Do you know something about it?
I don't really know. I do Python, the C implementation of Python only allows one thread to run in the interpreter at the moment. If I remember correctly. If you have multiple threads, then you have one of them running in the interpreter loop, and the other ones are either blocked or they're busy in extension code. So what does that mean to us? You're probably, as long as the libraries are thread safe, as long as the extensions are thread safe, insofar as that can be said, then you probably don't have too much trouble from the Python code itself shouldn't have too much of a problem with lack of a modern memory model. Perl, I don't know, I'm afraid.
Adding to that, but it means that the Python code will only run on basically one thread from the operating system point of view, one CPU.
Yes.
So if you have 18 CPUs, you're only running one of them on Python.
Well, yeah, but like the blocking modules, you can do.
So basically, Python threads are only a way of avoiding the application from blocking.
Yeah, right. Oh, I think you can even run like C extension code like in separate track, like, right?
Yes. And then so if one thread is running interpreted Python code, and then another thread comes back from running an extension, it will block the interpreter lock. But if you have long running if you have functions in extensions that do long-running pieces of work, then you may be able to make use of good use of multiple processes. Haven't seen it happen in practice. At work we have a rather large Python testing framework. There we use multiple processes.
I could give another perspective. At the previous job, we were implementing a functional programming language, a purely functional programming language with multi-threading support. Pure functional programming language, meaning that it is impossible to change a value.
Yes, and there's a big advantage there.
Yeah. Which means that basically locking is not necessary. You do not need to lock data because it never changes. You just create more data, and the old data will eventually go away.
But yeah. That's someone else's problem to deal with.
Yeah, but the most functional programming language is a garbage collector, and so
yes.
This is another problem. How did you manage memory?
Our garbage collector was thread safe. I don't know exactly how it was implemented. It became a PhD, not mine.
The same multi-threading Perl program that I have the problem with. I was using a Perl library that didn't document whether it was thread safe or not, and it wound up not being thread safe, of course. And so I wound up as the easiest way to change my multi-threading implementation. I have multi-threads controlling multi-processes. So each process has one thread doing the I/O handling for that one process, and I wound up having to figure out how to basically do a subroutine call to another thread, so I didn't have to.
Yeah.
You know, so one thread can handle the I/O to a file, so it doesn't have issues with the multi-threads trying to I/O to the same file at the same time. So, if any anyone needs to see how I did that, I can show them offline somewhere sometime. This is for the bug tracking system, by the way, the spam scan. Basically, one spam assassin process was not able to keep up with the amount of email we get to the bug tracking system. And so I had to rewrite it to have more than one spam assassin. It's mainly network delay.
Right, so you have you have threads blocking all the time, is that it?
Yes.
Right. That's unpleasant. Mm-hmm. Is there any way you can turn it into sort of an event loop so that the processing continues when you get a response from the network?
Like I said, each spam assassin is a Perl library, basically. It's got programs that can call the Perl library, but it's the back end is actually a Perl library. And we've written this program in Perl. I wound up rewriting 90% of it. And the one thread locks on the I/O to the process running a single spam assassin. And as the messages get processed, it unblocks the thread and then handles it fairly. You know, of course, I have a lot of blocks and so on and so forth to make sure that the threads don't stomp over each other. And then I run up to 20 processes running spam assassin at a time.
How many processes, how many processors do you have to run this on?
It's a dual hyper-threading Xeon system, so two or four depending upon how you count.
So you've got to overlook those arrival, a lot of the processor, you've got to overlook the processors that are actually idle.
Yes.
Otherwise. Is that it?
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. I'm not quite sure what the next talk is, but it's probably tomorrow. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.